Johnson Talks Books. My guest today is truly a Renaissance man of music because he has composed ballets, he has composed operas, he has composed symphonies, but he also has composed Happy Days theme song, Love American Style, and on the opposite side of the front page is the music to Killing Me Softly with Your Songs. Well, the book is titled Killing Me Softly. It's My Life in Music by Charles Fox, and it's published by Scarecrow Press. Welcome, Charles.
Thanks, Connie. So nice to be here with you.
Oh, well, what a story. Here is this little boy. We're in Brooklyn.
Bronx.
In the Bronx, with his piano teacher living in the same building.
Right. Yeah.
And he would go up a few flights, and there would be his lesson, clutching his little $2.
Yeah, in my pocket, my folded neatly in my pocket.
And she is the one who says to your parents, he has a future, and he should apply to go to study with Mademoiselle Nadia Boulanger.
Right, right. You know, I was working in, I graduated High School of Music and Art, and I started studying with this lady, Nora Uhrberg, who was my first piano teacher, when I was probably about 8 or 9 years old. And she prepared me to for the auditions to Music and Art High School. And when I graduated from there, I really didn't want to go into college. I didn't want a formal education system. I continued to study privately with my composition teacher there from school, who was also a great influence on me. But I was also playing in bands around New York and earning a little living. Yeah. And one day I came home from a job late at night, maybe 3 o'clock in the morning, and she was out walking her dog, and we talked a little bit. And she said, so what are you doing with your life? And I said, well, I'm doing music, I'm playing, I'm writing arrangements, I'm writing songs, mostly songs in Spanish those days, because I was playing with Latin bands, which I didn't speak Spanish, but I had a good feel for it. So she said, well, what about Juilliard? And I said, you know, I just really don't want to be in a formal education system. She said, there's a woman in France who's extraordinary, who was the teacher of Aaron Copland many years ago, generations of American and composers from around the world. Yehudi Menuhin was a great violinist, studied with her. Prince Rainier, as it turns out, was a godson, actually. She has a school she's the head of in Fontainebleau, France. Just for the summer, that might be a wonderful thing for you to do. So I said to her, it sounds fantastic. Going to France would be a dream from the Bronx, you know. I said, I'm sure that my parents couldn't afford to send me there. She said, I'll talk to your parents. And as you said, she lived on the fifth floor. We lived on the ground floor. And I don't know exactly what she said to my mother and father to convince them that they should send me to Paris. But somehow they found the money to do it, and it changed my life.
Yeah.
It totally changed my life.
What changed the writer life is that somebody came across, your parents had saved the letters you wrote about your experiences in Paris.
Right. When I got to Paris, France, actually, it was only for the summer. There was a music school conservatoire right in the palace grounds, right in the palace. Mm-hmm. And it was only for the summer, but Nadia Boulanger, first of all, she gave me a whole life in music, and I feel that way to this day. But from my very first lesson, I knew that my life's work would be to compose. So there was something that emanated from her, some sparks, some life. She looked at some of my pieces, and she told me what she did like, what she didn't like. And after a while, she said she'd like me to come to Paris to study with her for the winter. And I ended up with being there for 2 years. I never paid her for a lesson, and I saw her 3 or 4 times a week for lessons. It wasn't a question of a scholarship. She just knew I was eager and hungry to learn.
Yeah.
And she had plenty of students that she charged, I guess, enough money. So it was a turning point in my life.
And she would include you in her cocktail parties.
Oh, absolutely.
And the exposure. And I am sure for the kid from the Bronx,
right,
that she also said, I think you should wear a tie today, Charles.
Oh, more than that. More than that.
Okay.
She wouldn't admit me to her house today like this.
Yeah.
If a man wasn't wearing a necktie, he was naked. This is very formal France now.
Yeah.
So I wore a suit and a tie every day because I saw her 3 or 4 times a week. And I lived not too far away, and I never knew if I'd been suddenly invited over to her house for dinner or something, or maybe she'd I didn't have a telephone, but she would send someone this, you know, tickets for a show or a concert rather. So I always had a tie in Paris. Yeah.
Well, the stories of that part of your life are, it's like a movie, it's like Gene Kelly, American in Paris. You come back, though, to this country, and what do? You go back to the Catskills to play with the Latin band.